We have with us today Ganesh Devi, academic, writer, the moving force behind the People's Linguistic Survey of India, and activist. Thank you, Ganesh, for being here with me today. I want to begin with your phone call to me a few evenings back, on the fifth evening, when you called and said, they've got Gauri. What struck me then was that heartbreaking link that when Dabolkar was killed, Pansare fought for bringing the murderers to book. When Pansare was killed, Kalburgi was part of those who spoke up. When Kalburgi was killed, Gauri Lankesh was very much part of the movement to demand justice. And now Gauri too is gone. So I thought we would begin by talking about the link between what we are calling political murders.
So I met her on the 26th, and this was in Bangalore. This was just at the entrance of the Chief Minister's residence. And both of us independently had gone there to ask for speeding up of investigation in Dr. Kalburgi's assassination case. So she was a fighter, and Dr. Kalburgi's murder, the attack on rationalism, these were her causes, but she also had other causes. She was trying to bring those who are jumping the social margins back to normalcy by restoring sense in the political dispensation. She was a visionary activist. Yes. She got angry, but every time she was angry, she had a thought and a new thought to give. In this case, there is a similarity between the earlier three assassinations and this, but there are also differences.
Yes, but let's look at, I see two levels of linkages. One is that all four were voices of questioning, of dissent, if you want to use the word. They worked all their lives against caste divisions, for equality, let me say, in a broad sense. So that was one aspect. The other set of linkages, of course, is the way in which their voices were silenced. And since you've mentioned that you met her a few days back, actually, at the Chief Minister's, perhaps we should look at the second set of linkages first. What was the Chief Minister's reaction? I think you were there with Megha Pansare.
Well, we said to this CM that they must do this fast. It is already 2 years. And he said that he will issue a statement. We said issuing a statement is easy, but the statement must be matched by action. So he said that there will be action. He said that to Gauri as well, later on the same day. Mm-hmm. And this is the, it's really tragic, it's sad, that while she was hoping to have action, she got a counter action. Now, at least hopefully, there will be some investigations. But there are two or three different things. One is investigation in the case. That kind of insistence should be there for the murder of anybody, even a person belonging to any political party or person not belonging to any political party, for any citizen, with Aadhaar card or without Aadhaar card. A murder takes place, there must be investigation, speedy. That is the question of law and order. The second is political opposition. Say we all know that Kalburgi, Gauri, Dabolkar, Pansare, they went down because they had certain political views. That is terrible, terrible. But if this is limited only to that, it would be a tragedy on a scale. But at the moment, what is happening is a tragedy on a much larger scale, and that is, it is not just the attack on Gauri or Pansare or Dabolkar, it's an attack on civilization. See, completely ruthless, mindless, inhuman, monstrous attack. Attack on Gauri is a political metaphor for attack on democracy. Because this time they are hit at the soul of democracy. Media is the soul of the people are the heart of dissent is the heart of democracy. But media alone, while it does not represent anybody, is able to raise conscience. The voice of conscience is raised by media. That is its role, the ideal media. And this time they have attacked on the conscience of democracy. And that is a civilizational assault in an unprecedented, unparalleled way. There have been attacks on media in the past. There was the emergency, of course, people were imprisoned. But the brutality with which individuals are being picked up and maimed to death, and after doing that, that is being justified by using words which I cannot even mention, that is frightening.
Yes, you've actually made an important point, because while at this point we do not know, it's not so much a question of us ordinary citizens saying who killed Gauri Lankesh, but we certainly, many people have been saying, we know who is rejoicing at this political murder, who is actually saying this in public space. Let me step back for a minute and say, why are these specific voices being silenced? And while they're individuals, they also represent a constituency that is willing to speak up, that is willing to engage as citizens. You have been part of the groups trying to get justice for Dabolkar, Pansare, Kalburgi. You've worked with Gauri Lankesh. Let's talk about the nature of their lives, their engagements. Gauri was involved with the anti-Madesnana, the superstition, anti-Dalit superstition, or the Baba Budangiri. I know that you worked with her on the Chalo Udupi. So would you give us an idea of the concerns she was passionate about?
Yes, I will. Also Kalburgi.
Yes.
While Veera Shaivism, that is the Lingayat sect, came up, it came up in challenge to all kinds of social and theological restrictions, and it brought people together. Hindu Muslim rituals were combined. In among the Lingayats, Janoi, which is their right, they call it Ishtalinga. Women and men both are allowed to wear that, unlike in any other religion. Now, over centuries, this had been Brahminized. And the some people who established mutts, they were controlling both religion and politics. Kalburgi did not go to either politics or the mutts, but he did solid scholarly work to show that the vision of Lingayat is different than what is being practiced. This became a his 120 books, which tell the true story of the origin and development of Lingayat faith, became a huge political challenge to the Hindus. because Hindus had started claiming Lingayat as part of the larger Hindu society.
And made them a separate caste,
yes.
Actually a travesty of
travesty.
What Basavanna
spoke the truth
of.
His truth had to be suppressed for political interest. Now in Gauri's case, she was constantly speaking in favor of two things. One is the marginalized, but not just the economically marginalized, marginalized and the ones who are denied justice and understanding.
Yes.
Sometimes the dispensations become blind towards the needs to understand the rights issue of the marginalized, not just the economic rights. And so she had chosen that as her constituency, and she had chosen the second within the field of journalism, that is anything she wrote had to have action to back it, like W.B. Yeats said, no, if poetry does not spring from the ground, it will remain weak. So she had cultivated, she had developed, she brought great sophistication to the art of combining social involvement and concern for the society, thought for the society, to its ultimate point. Lankesh, her father, had started that, but she brought perfection to this, and I think that was hurting the post-truth media. And it was also hurting the globalized political frames.
We mustn't forget that Gauri Lankesh Patrike and Lankesh Patrike did not take advertisements.
Yes. She had two reasons to for making people feeling disturbed by what she was doing. And the third was, and that was even more important, she was a woman.
Absolutely.
And a fearless woman.
Absolutely.
And she did not fit into any caste, any mold, any gender mold. I think so she brought together three kinds of freedom struggles, and therefore three kinds of oppositions, and therefore the attack on her was the most brutal, 7 bullets. Well, for Dabolkar it was 2 bullets. I mean, having fewer bullets does not make it milder. But the ruthlessness with which she was killed has no parallel in
but
recent history.
Ganesh, you made a really important point, because in a way she epitomized everything that the promoters of division and hatred fear. And she was a kind of perfect example, if you like. You're a woman, you're a journalist, you're outspoken, you act through your work as well as your life as a citizen. Let me use that point to look ahead, because in a way we would not only be letting ourselves down as citizens at this juncture, but also what Dabolkar and Pansare and Kalburgi and Gauri stood for in very different ways, if we didn't think of the way ahead. What are we going to do now against this backdrop of not only the creation of fear in constituencies that want to speak in different ways, but also the fact that people are gloating
it's simple.
Over these murders.
To me, it's simple. In the history from Buddha's times till today, whenever there was a social reform, a fundamentally social reformist movement, whenever there had to rise a completely new thought in India, generations together, people had to make sacrifices. This is in the history of the Sikh faith. This is in the history of the Lingayat faith, beginning with Basveshwar himself. I think this will be remembered in future as a glorious beginning of renewal and rebirth of Indian society, where Hinduism is made a more human way of respecting diversity.
And
a democratic.
How do we start this?
These are the first steps. Because with every martyr, the utter wrong which has saturated for a long time, it is not just the wrong generated today, though there are three factories of generating these wrongs. One is the tyranny of the unelected coming from Nagpur. The other is the hegemony of the middle class, who feel that so long as their soap is a foreign soap, everything is all right. And then there is the autocratic elements in the government, who think that they alone know what progress is. They have strange ideas. But all of these three are a result of what has saturated in the Indian society through caste divide, caste and tribe divide, gender divide. And this is the ugliest face of the terrible history we have inherited. I think this is the beginning of a new India in a different way. One feels individually sorry for the families, but in history, in future, these martyrdoms will be remembered as a glorious beginning of a new thought. I'm not saying this just to make myself feel comfortable, but I'm saying that all of us should be ready to pay this cost now.
Yes,
And with Gauri, 8:05, the news came to me. At 8:40, there were people in the streets of Dharwad protesting. Next morning, 3,000 students came out in the silent Dharwad. There was a protest in Islampur, in Maharashtra, in Kolhapur, in Sangli, in Karnataka, of course, every city, every town. But in Maharashtra, places like Islampur, Nashik, Pune, Satara, Sangli, who have in the past never thought they had to do anything with what happens in Karnataka. In Gorakhpur, there was a protest. In Chandigarh, there was a protest. In Delhi, of course, there was a protest. In Bombay. What I am saying is, because this was an attack on the soul of democracy, I think somewhere it has hurt the soul of India. And this is a soul awakening moment for India. Every birth begins with pain. So it is a birth giving pain that we experience.
Thank you, Ganesh. I think it's clear that the need of the moment is for all of us to harness our spontaneous outrage, our pain, and actually build this new India you're talking about, an India without the divisions that have kept us apart too long. Thank you.